Morning. Thank you, Ed. I appreciate that reading. My wife and I, we sometimes go on walks, and what we do is while we're walking, we'll memorize the scriptures. And this 2 Corinthians verses, chapter 4, verse 6 through 12, that's one of our passages that we memorize and re-memorize and re-memorize because we forget it. So you probably thought you were getting off easy with six verses, but that's not going to happen today. Because as I studied this passage, it was evident that this particular section is part of a larger discussion. So in order to understand the verses in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, we need to go back to 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 1. So our text is going to start this morning in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 1. I want to start with some background to the book. You might remember that the Apostle Paul, on his second missionary journey, had left Athens. He'd gone to the city of Corinth. And when Paul arrived in Corinth, he met a certain Jew, the scripture says, named Aquila, along with his wife Priscilla. And they came to Christ. And then Paul, as he often did, went into the local synagogue there in Corinth. And it says that he reasoned in the synagogue every Sabbath and that he persuaded both Jews and Greeks there in Corinth. And it also tells us that the ruler of the synagogue, a man named Crispus, believed on the Lord with all his household. And it says that many of the Corinthians, upon hearing the gospel, believed and they were baptized. Now, some time back, I preached on 1 Corinthians chapter 15, and I noted that the culture of Corinth was heavily influenced by Greek or Hellenistic thought, and this culture is brought into the church when these Greek guys got saved, Greek men and women got saved. And this influenced the way that they saw things spiritually, right? But what I want to make clear today is that Greek thought wasn't the only influence in the church at Corinth, because the Apostle Paul, here in 2 Corinthians chapters 3 and 4, is going to be talking about another major influence in the church at Corinth, and that was Judaism. And as we just discussed, when Paul arrived in Corinth, he immediately went and he met a couple named Aquila and Priscilla. And they were Jews who were living in Corinth at the time. And Paul spoke to them about the Lord Jesus. They were saved. And he went to the synagogue in Corinth and he started to preach there. And it says that many Jews and Greeks believed. So there was this amalgamation of Jew and Greek in the Corinthian church, as it should be. So Old Testament Jewish thought is brought into the church at Corinth by the Jews who believed in Jesus, along with all this Greek philosophy. So Paul, in his first letter to the Corinthians, had to counter the influence of Greek thought on these believers in the church at Corinth. But here in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, Paul is now going to deal with Jewish false teachers. And these people are from outside of the Corinthian church. They come in, and they're trying to bring these new believers at Corinth under the influence of Judaism, back under the Old Testament law. They are trying to move the believers away from the grace of the gospel and put them back under the burden of the Old Testament law. And just like Paul had dealt with the influence of Greek issues, specifically Gnosticism, in multiple churches, so he's going to deal with the influence of Judaism in multiple churches, not just here in Corinth. And so we start here in 2 Corinthians chapter 3. This is where we're finding ourselves. Paul is confronting some false teachers that have come in from the outside. They're attempting to bring the believers at Corinth under the influence and under the burden of the Old Testament law. And in the process, they are trying to destroy Paul's reputation as an apostle. And so Paul starts off in chapter 3 defending himself against the attacks of these false teachers, sometimes called Judaizers. If I can get this to work. There we go. Okay, so here we begin at 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 1. Paul writes, he says, "Do we begin again to commend ourselves? Or do we need, as some others, epistles of commendation to you, or letters of commendation from you? So right off the bat here, Paul is confronting the accusation by these false teachers that he is not preaching the truth, that he is not an authority who can be trusted, that he doesn't have the backing of Peter and the other apostles. So these false teachers evidently came there with letters of commendation from somebody. Whether they were authentic or not is debatable, but evidently they came into the church at Corinth with letters from someone indicating that they had authority to speak for the church leadership. And it appears that they pretend to speak for Peter and the other apostles at Jerusalem. So Paul says to the believers at Corinth, he says, "Do I really need to write a letter of commendation to you?" And he goes on to write in verse 2, he says, "You are our epistle written in our hearts, known and read by all. Clearly you are an epistle of Christ, ministered by us, written not with ink, but by the Spirit of the living God, not on tablets of stone, but on tablets of flesh," that is, of the heart. So Paul is reminding these believers at Corinth that he was the one who preached the gospel to them originally, and that his letter of commendation is not written with ink on a piece of paper, but it was written by the Spirit of the living God when Paul preached the gospel to them and they were saved. Okay? And Paul here at the end of verse 3 makes reference to where the conflict lies with these Judaizers when he says that the Spirit of the living God wrote not on tablets of stone. That's a reference to the Old Covenant, right? It's a reference to the Old Covenant, which is what these opponents of Paul were teaching, about how important it was to follow the Old Covenant. But Paul says that when I preach to you, the Spirit of the living God wrote not on tablets of stone, but on tablets of flesh. That is the heart. So Paul is contrasting the Old Covenant here with the New Covenant. So he describes what they are preaching and teaching as written on tablets of stone. And he's, of course, referencing the giving of the Ten Commandments written on tablets of stone, right? But stone, Paul says, by implication, is dead. It's inanimate, as opposed to what I'm preaching and teaching, and that is that what he taught was written on the heart. Okay? It is living, it is vibrant, it touches the heart. It's not outward. It's not outward, it's inward. Not having any luck here, guys. Thank you. Well, Paul goes on to say in this letter, chapter 3, verses 4 through 6, he says, "And we have such trust through Christ toward God, not that we are sufficient of ourselves to think of anything as being from ourselves, but our sufficiency is from God, who also made us sufficient as ministers of the new covenant." And I want you to listen especially to this. He says, "For the letter kills. For the letter kills, but the Spirit gives life." So he writes concerning this teaching of these Judaizers. He says, "For the letter kills, but the Spirit gives life." So he is contrasting the letter of the law, in other words, Judaism under the Old Covenant, as a killing thing. He says the letter kills. He contrasts that with the gospel, which he writes regarding it, that it gives life by the Spirit of God. Next, thank you. And he goes on to write in chapter 3, verse 7, he says, "But if the ministry of death, written and engraved on stones, was glorious so that the children of Israel could not look steadily at the face of Moses because of the glory of his countenance, which glory was passing away." That's all right. Verse 8. "How will this ministry of the Spirit not be more glorious? For if the ministry of condemnation had glory, the ministry of righteousness exceeds much more in glory. For even what was made glorious had no glory in this respect, because of the glory that excels. For if what is passing away was glorious, what remains is much more glorious." Now, Paul, in these four verses, that's chapter 3, verses 7 through 11, describes the Old Testament law, the Old Covenant, as the ministry of death, in verse 7, and then also the ministry of condemnation in verse 9. In contrast, he describes the gospel or his teaching, that is the new covenant, in verse 8 as the ministry of the Spirit and the ministry of righteousness in verse 9. So you can see Paul's argument here. He says about the old covenant, he says, hey, the law was written on stone, but the new covenant is written on your very own hearts. The old covenant is a ministry of death. It condemns. There is no life there. The new covenant, on the other hand, is a ministry of the Spirit of the living God. It's alive. It produces righteousness, not a false righteousness. Okay, it's not on the outside for the world to see, but on the inside, on your heart, where only God can see, right? So you see this contrast. Paul is laying out the evidence for the superiority of the gospel. He speaks in this section about the glory that attended the giving of the law, or the old covenant, right? He's referencing back to the book of Exodus, and you'll remember in that account that when Moses went to the top of Mount Sinai to receive the law, that because he was in the presence of the Lord, his face was glowing. But Paul says that whatever glory attended the giving of the law, that glory began to pass away as soon as Moses left the presence of God. It started to fade. And he says there in verse 11 that if what is passing away, what is he talking about? He's talking about the law of Moses. It says, if what is passing away was glorious, what remains, that is the gospel, Paul's teaching, is much more glorious. Amen? I lost my place. In other words, the glory of the old covenant pales in comparison to the glory of the new covenant. Amen? Now, in verses 12 through 18, Paul is going to grab onto this scene at Mount Sinai, God's encounter with Moses there, and he's going to use that as imagery to try and convince the believers at Corinth of the inferiority of the old covenant and the superiority of the new covenant, much like happens in the book of Hebrews, right? Verses 12 through 18 says, therefore, since we have such hope, we use great boldness of speech, unlike Moses, who put a veil over his face so that the children of Israel could not look steadily at the end of what was passing away, but their minds were blinded, for until this day the same veil remains unlifted in the reading of the Old Testament, because the veil is taken away in Christ. But even to this day, when Moses is read, a veil lies on their heart. Nevertheless, when one turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. But we all, with unveiled face, beholding as in a mirror the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from glory to glory, just as by the Spirit of the Lord. Paul writes that he has great boldness of speech in declaring the gospel, and he contrasts that with the giving of the law of Moses. When he says, unlike Moses, who put a veil over his face. Paul uses the illustration of the veil on the face of Moses as a metaphor for the thing that is preventing the Jews from seeing the truth of the gospel. You remember when Moses came down that mountain that the people couldn't even look at his face. It was so bright. So he had to put a veil on it. And Paul's using that veil as a metaphor for the thing that's preventing the Jews from seeing the truth of the gospel. He writes that the veil is taken away in Christ. Okay, that is, when someone puts their faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, if you're one of those this morning, I hope you are, their eyes are opened, the veil is removed, and now they see the truth. Okay, and that's my testimony. I mean, I had read the Bible 10 times probably, parts of the Bible 10 times, if not more. I didn't understand any of it. I got saved, I understood the Scriptures. I had the Spirit of God living within me then, right? The veil is taken away in Christ. That is when someone puts their faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, their eyes are opened. The veil is removed, and now they see the truth. In verse 16, Paul writes that when one turns to the Lord, that the veil is taken away. There's no longer anything between you and the truth upon belief on the Lord Jesus Christ. Paul writes in verse 17 that where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. That is in opposition to the law, right? Where there is no liberty. There is only a rigid, strict keeping of the law under the old covenant. Paul writes in verse 18, he says, but we all. The all is not just Paul and the apostles, right? Paul and the chosen few, but Paul and everyone who's put their faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. He writes, but we all with unveiled face. That's you and me too, if we're believers in Christ, right? We all with unveiled face, that is, as opposed to Moses, who had his face veiled so that the glory of God could not be seen. We all of us believers, go out with an unveiled face. And as we behold the glory of the Lord, that's the Lord Jesus Christ, right? The glory of the Lord Jesus Christ. Paul writes that we are being transformed into the same image from glory to glory, just as by the Spirit of the Lord. You know, the most greatest example of this meeting, of this to me, is a meeting we have here before this meeting. What do? At the breaking of bread meeting, we gaze on the Lord Jesus Christ. That's what we do. And as we gaze on him, we are changed from glory to glory, right? For the Christian, as we gaze at the Lord, we experience ever-increasing glory. It's written here in the New King James Version as from glory to glory. It is ever-increasing because we are indwelt by the eternal, infinite Spirit of God, and we are being transformed by the Spirit into Christ's same image. 2 Corinthians 4, verse 1, Paul writes, therefore, since we have this ministry, as we have received mercy, we do not lose heart. Paul writes, therefore, since we have this ministry. What ministry is that? It's the ministry that God had given Paul, right? Paul was an apostle. Paul was an evangelist. Paul was a church planner. Paul was an apologist. Paul writes, as we have received mercy, we do not lose heart. Remember who Paul was before he was Paul, right? He was Saul, right? He was a blasphemer. He was a persecutor of the church. But God in his mercy saved Paul. And Paul never forgot that. Paul never forgot that. The thing that kept Paul moving forward in the work of the gospel was remembering the mercy of God shown to him. If God in his mercy would save Paul, he knew that in his mercy God would sustain him through all of the trials that came with the ministry that God had given him to perform. Paul had lots of trials for the sake of the gospel, and yet he says here that he did not lose heart. He never gave up. Paul remembered who he was. Paul remembered who he was and how God in his mercy had saved him, so he did not lose heart. He did not lose heart. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 2, Paul writes, but we have renounced the hidden things of shame, not walking in craftiness nor handling the word of God deceitfully, commending ourselves to every man's conscience in the sight of God. Paul here is defending himself against these accusations from the Judaizers who have shown up in Corinth, who said that Paul was lying, or Paul was somehow distorting the word of God for his own gain. But Paul says here that I never did that. I never deceived you. And he says, I was an open book among you. He says, the only thing I told you was the truth, the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. And I believe he is saying to them, you know this. You saw me. And you saw how I lived among you. And he appeals to their conscience, right? Chapter 4, verses 3 and 4. But even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing, whose minds the God of this age has blinded, who do not believe, lest the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine on them. Now, Paul starts this section by saying, even if our gospel is veiled. I think Paul's referring to these false teachers who came in after Paul and said, no, Paul is wrong. Paul is wrong. There's more to salvation than simple faith in Jesus Christ. I mean, you have to keep the law. And so Paul refers to these Judaizers when he writes, even if our gospel is veiled. These unbelieving, false teachers cannot see the truth of the gospel because, Paul says, that they have yielded to the deception of Satan. That is who is referred to when he says in verse 4, he says, the God of this age. That's not God, Almighty God. It's Satan. The God of this age is Satan. And Paul writes, whose mind the God of this age has blinded, who do not believe. And he says about the Judaizers, he says, they can't see the gospel. They're lost. They've been deceived by Satan. They don't believe. And as a result of their unbelief, he says that the light of the gospel won't shine on them. There is a veil between them and the truth of the gospel. Now, Paul keeps referring back to this Mount Sinai event when Moses went up on that mountain and met with God in the undiminished light of Almighty God. And as a result, his face reflected the brilliance of God so much so that he had to wear a veil. And here he hearkens back to that event when he says, lest the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine on them. They won't believe so that the light of the gospel would shine on them. And he tells them in this phrase that the gospel manifests itself, shows forth or unveils the glory of Christ, who, he says, is the image of God. I don't want you to miss that. The Lord Jesus Christ is God himself. Amen? And if there were any doubt about what Paul is saying regarding the Lord Jesus Christ, there can be no doubt here. These Judaizers have somehow made Christ less than who he is. They have somehow made Christ less than who he is. I mean, that's the sign of all false religion, isn't it? They make Jesus into something that he's not. Somehow Christ was not enough, and so now it is up to you, church at Corinth, to keep the law so you can be saved. But Paul says, no, 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 no. Christ is the image of Almighty God, and when you believe in him alone, in his work alone for your salvation, his glory will shine on you. Amen? Paul writes in verse 5, he says, for we do not preach ourselves, but Christ Jesus the Lord, and ourselves your bondservants for Jesus' sake. Again, Paul clarifies the message that it is Christ alone who he preaches. Christ alone who he preaches. And that's what we preach here. That is what we preach here. Christ alone. Paul says we don't preach ourselves. We're just servants. We're servants of the Lord Jesus Christ, and we're your servant as well for his sake. The gospel is about Jesus Christ, period. Amen? It's not about Paul. It's not about Peter. It's not about Moses, it's not about you, it's not about me. It is simply Christ. It is simply Christ and Christ alone. Amen? Now we come to the group of verses that started this whole journey for me. And here we are, chapter 4, verse 6. Only took us about 25 minutes to get here. And these are some powerful, powerful verses, brothers and sisters. If you haven't memorized them, memorize them. For it is the God who commanded light to shine out of darkness, who has shown in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. Paul refers back to creation when he writes that God commanded light to shine out of darkness, right? And Paul writes and says that just like when God commanded light to shine out of darkness at creation, he has now shown in our hearts that we might believe the gospel and that we would see the glory of God in the person of Jesus Christ in all of his brilliance. Paul keeps referring back to this light. There was the brilliance of light at the creation. There was the brilliance of light on Mount Sinai, on the face of Moses. And now, far surpassing all other light, the brilliance of light in the face of Jesus Christ. Far surpassing it. The undiminished light of the Son of God. I couldn't help think about the Apostle Paul when he got saved, right? I mean, he didn't get saved like you and I got saved. He's walking down the Damascus Road, going after Christians. The Lord Jesus Christ appears to him. I forget how the scripture says it, but it's this unapproachable light, this undiminished light that comes on the Apostle Paul. I think maybe Paul's thinking back to that experience when he's saying these things. Chapter 4, verse 7. But we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellence of the power may be of God and not of us. What is the treasure that Paul is referring to? The treasure is the light of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. And Paul says about this treasure that we have it in earthen vessels. I think in other translations it's translated as clay pots. What are the clay pots or these earthen vessels that Paul's referring to? It is our bodies. It is our bodies, these fragile clay pots where the light of the gospel is stored. And why does God's planning have such a priceless treasure in such a fragile, weak vessel? Paul says he does that so that it will be obvious to anyone that sees that it is the power of God working in this person as they deal with the trials of life. It obviously cannot be anything of themselves that allows them to bear it. As Paul writes here, he says that the excellence of the power may be of God and not of us. You know, one of the things that can really discourage us is when we have the great difficulties in life, right? And I've been an eyewitness. I've seen wonderful, godly people go through great suffering, seemingly for no reason at all. Godly, faithful people, children of God, going through horrific trials. And I wonder, and I'm sure you do too, what's going on? What's going on? Why are these things happening? I think this verse gives us a reason for Christian suffering, right? I think Paul, in these handful of verses, including verses 7 through verse 12, is referring to the suffering that he personally experienced because of persecution as he preached the gospel. But I think the application is not isolated to persecution for our faith. I think it applies to all trials and suffering experienced by believers in Jesus Christ. Verse 7 tells us the reason for our trial. It is that the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ would shine through us, even in our lowest moments, maybe especially in our lowest moments. As cracks develop in these clay pots, these earthen vessels, due to the stress of life, whether by persecution, whether by physical ailments, whether by emotional distress, whether by financial difficulties, I don't think it matters. I don't think it matters. As cracks develop in us because of these different stressors, the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ shines through us. And I've seen this played out. Like I said, I've seen it played out in the lives of people who are no longer with us, now gone and with the Lord. And I've seen it, and I've seen some of you during great trials, and I see you in the midst of those trials, continuing to walk by faith, continuing to trust the Lord, and shining the light of the glory of the gospel of Jesus Christ all around for everybody to see. And I want to say it's a great encouragement to me. It's a great encouragement to me and to my faith to see you every Sunday at church walking with the Lord, spreading the light despite the trial that you find yourself in. So thank you. Verse 8, Paul writes, he says, We are hard-pressed on every side, yet we're not crushed. I mean, can you imagine what Paul was feeling in some of those experiences that he had? Hard-pressed on every side, he says. The pressure that he was under in some of those places that he found himself. And we find ourselves in places like this where the pressure seems enormous and that we cannot bear it. It's not a good place to find yourself in. Yet Paul says that despite the pressure that he was not crushed. I want you to notice that Paul felt the pressure. He didn't just go through all these trials as if they were nothing, right? Amen? I think sometimes we feel like we somehow don't measure up to some lofty spiritual standard because we're in distress when we're going through something. But Paul doesn't say he wasn't in distress. In fact, he says that they were hard-pressed on every side. But he says even in that pressure cooker of a situation, he says we were not crushed. He goes on to say, he says, we are perplexed, but not in despair. Again, I think we can feel like we're supposed to have all the answers to everything as people of faith. I hear well-meaning people wanting to help people through some difficulty try to explain why God is allowing this specific thing to happen to them. I think it's a mistake. I think Paul here is saying sometimes there is no pat answer that we're going to understand. Paul says that he was perplexed. This great apostle didn't understand why he was in this situation. I mean, he's God's apostle. He's God's minister. Why am I going through this, Lord? He's perplexed. I mean, if the apostle Paul can be perplexed, we can be perplexed, brothers and sisters. We can be perplexed. It's okay for me to question why this is going on in my life. But Paul says this, he says, I do not understand it. I do not understand it, but I'm not in despair. I'm not hopeless. And I'm going to continue to walk by faith and trust that God knows what he is doing. He goes on to write in verse 9, he says, persecuted but not forsaken, struck down but not destroyed. You know, Paul was God's apostle. He was a child of God. Yet he experienced great pressure, he experienced doubt, he experienced great persecution, he experienced physical beatings. Now, in the world, according to me, none of these things would happen, right? Paul would have gone through life protected, shielded from harm while he did the Lord's work, but that's not what happened to him. And in the world, according to me, the people of God would be protected and shielded from all harm while they live their lives and do the Lord's work. So needless to say, I am perplexed frequently, okay? But I tell you this, I am trusting that God has something in mind, some purpose in all this persecution and suffering by his people. Chapter 4, verse 10, and this is going to be our final verse. Paul writes about all this suffering that he's done. He writes in verse 10, he says, always carrying about in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus, that the life of Jesus also may be manifested in our body. You know, essentially he's repeated verse 7 here in verse 10. In verse 7 he wrote, but we have this treasure in earthen vessels that the excellence of the power may be of God and not of us. Here he writes, always carrying about the dying in the body, the dying of the Lord Jesus, that the life of Jesus also may be manifested in our body. The Apostle Paul lived through some horrific suffering in his life. Later on in this same letter of 2 Corinthians in chapter 11, he describes some of the things that he went through. He describes this as part of his defense against these false teachers. For the sake of time, I'm going to summarize it. He was shipwrecked. He was beaten with rods. He was stoned and left for dead. He was whipped. He was constantly in danger. And most of these things he went through multiple times, not just once. And he notes that he bore the burden of caring for all of the churches that he had planted. As Paul went through all these things, he felt all this great pressure that he was under. There were times when he was perplexed. He questioned the Lord, why am I going through this? And I don't think Paul, even at the end of his life, could tell you specifically why he went through some of the things that he went through. But I think he got through these things by holding on to the idea, by holding on to the truth, that as he was going through this, that he had an opportunity to shine forth the glory of the Son of God, the glory of his Savior, the glory of his Master, the Lord Jesus Christ, who in his great mercy had saved Paul. Paul wrote, but I have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellence of the power may be of God and not of me. He wrote that I'm always carrying about in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus, that the life of Jesus may be manifested in my body. In this cracked, broken clay pot, I am going to shine forth the glory of the Lord Jesus Christ. The Apostle Paul wrote one time, he said, when I'm weak, then I'm strong. What? When you're weak, you're strong. Yeah, because the Lord Jesus Christ is shining through me. He is shining through me. Maybe the one lesson for us this morning from this passage is this. I don't need to understand the why of every specific trial that I go through. But I just need to understand this, that in all of my trials, God's overall purpose is that the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ would be made manifested to the world through me somehow. Can you imagine that? How is that going to happen? How is the Lord Jesus Christ going to shine through me? We have that opportunity. As weak and fragile as I am, he's going to shine through me. Amazing. I'm going to end with a benediction. I've never done a benediction before. Well, I think it's appropriate, given what we've talked about. I tried to write my own benediction. It's pretty lame, to be honest with you. So I looked up benedictions in the Bible. And this one I was familiar with, and it's perfect for this message that I'm preaching this morning. So I'm gonna give you a benediction, and then we're going to close with a hymn. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. We'll close with a hymn.